It's a very good afternoon to all of you, our cherished viewers of Hot Issues, and welcome to another exciting edition of your favorite current affairs program, Hot Issues. Now, this afternoon on Hot Issues, our focus is on health. You remember, in the build-up to the 2016 general elections, a lot of the campaign focused on health. Now, at the time, the then opposition NPP campaigned on a dying national health insurance scheme. They said, when voted into office, we would make sure that we are able to help the national health insurance scheme work again. Even during the appointment of the health minister, Honorable Kwajiman Menu, the president, Nana Akufo-Addo, made that point that he's taking him there to be able to help revive the national health insurance scheme. This afternoon, we are finding out what is wrong with the national health insurance scheme. How can we get the national health insurance scheme to work again? That is, if there is anything at all wrong with the National Health Insurance Scheme. When I return after this break, I'll be introducing my guest for this afternoon, and then we'll begin discussions on the National Health Insurance Scheme. I am Winston Amoa. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this break. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues, and my guest for this afternoon is one man who knows it when it comes to the National Health Insurance Scheme. In fact, he led the team to develop the National Health Insurance Scheme. So you see why he's joined us this afternoon on Hot Issues. My guest is Kwamina Amaosi Andoh, who led a team of experts to design the National Health Insurance Scheme. Good afternoon, sir, and thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, and nice to meet you.
Yes, I believe you're doing very well.
Yes, by the grace of God.
You've still been monitoring the National Health Insurance Scheme?
Very well. I monitor it every month.
You monitor it every month?
Yes.
We'll get to the monitoring and all of that, but in designing this whole policy, what did you envisage? What sort of policy did you want for us by way of a health insurance scheme?
Thank you very much. There are several types of or hybrids of health insurance schemes. And when you are designing health insurance scheme for a country, you look at critically at the country, there are some indicators that you have to consider. Ghana is a developing country with a lot of us children. In fact, 50% of us are children under 15 years. They are not earning any income, so they are dependents. They are vulnerable, and we cannot take any contribution from them. And then those who are working and receiving mandatory salary are very few. We call it about 1.5 to 2 million out of about 30 million working population. So if you multiply 1.5 or 2 million by 4, 8 million, it means that these are the only people that we can track their payment, their premium collection through the payee system, the payee tax system. Okay, the rest out of the 27 million, the rest either they cannot pay or they can pay intermittently through the premium correction property. And that is very difficult for a country like Ghana. So that informs our design. So we design a health insurance system for Ghana with three different types of schemes.
What were they?
Yeah, the first type is the private commercial health insurance scheme, which will be run strictly by commercial entities. In fact, insurance companies or any department of insurance, those days when they had the life insurance schemes,
yeah,
they can add to that. So we have, currently we have Bupa, we have Nationwide Insurance, I mean, which used to be on the Vanguard, is now company standing on its own because of the new law for the life insurance to stand on their own. So mostly have life insurance companies carry on with that. Then we also advocated for National Social Health Insurance Scheme.
What was that?
That is a scheme which will take up the informal economy, which we have huge in Ghana. And it will take about, if you take the 8 million that I talk about outside, then the rest, which is about say 12, 13 million will be in that scheme.
And how is that going to work?
That is going to work in this way. The scheme will be run, even though there's going to be an office at the national level with CEO, but it will basically be run by the district authorities, metropolitan and municipal authorities. So you have the district manager, metropolitan manager, and then municipal manager. And then they will run their own scheme with the subscribers. And the subscribers are those in the informal economy whose premiums cannot be collected through the payee system. And therefore, we will form what we call subscriber association for each community. And community, we define community at that time, and even still working as an electoral area headed by an assembly person, man or woman. So the assembly person with his committee of about 7 or 9, depending on the population, will set up to head the subscriber association. Each subscriber in the community is a member, but the committee will be the one who will collect the premium and then pay into the National Health Insurance Scheme. And they will not collect it free of charge. They will collect it at a commission. So that committee is viable. It's not something that is a free, no.
And so that was going to be something that you decided to
join. Yeah, we decided to do. And the committee, we say it took us a lot of study to arrive at that.
Yes, no, I mean,
and
for instance, if I'm in the informal sector,
yes.
I could just say, okay, I want to be part of the scheme,
yes.
And then I join it.
Yes.
It's not compulsion.
No, health insurance will be compulsory in Ghana, but the three schemes I'm talking about, so I'm now talking about the second scheme,
yes.
The National Social Health Insurance Scheme. So you can decide to join it, but normally it's consigned to those in the informal economy.
Okay.
If you're in the informal economy, you have to join that. If you are financial enough to join the mutual scheme, which I'm going to talk about, the third scheme, you can also do that. But the beauty of it is that we design it based on the Ebusian system in Ghana, the external clan. You know, when you go to your the rural area, we collect auto, the Ebusian, and then even the development levy, we all pay. And Tailors Association, Carpenters Association in the cities and other district areas also collect money. And at times they even collect their own taxes for the district assemblies at a premium, at a commission. Mm. So that is how we design it. And the beauty of it is that they are in the community and they know those who are indigents, who cannot do work, and therefore they cannot pay for health insurance. And they know those who can pay, and therefore they can easily collect the premium and then pay. And then they will have, maybe we will have to negotiate with them a certain percentage of the collection which goes to the organization, and they will use it to develop themselves.
Was there going to be
when
a flat?
Do that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, yes, it will be a flat premium,
rate.
Yes.
For everybody.
That, yes,
okay.
And that is the reason why we have to do this price discrimination. We have to do different markets. I've talked about the first market, that private for commercial. The second market is the mutual social health insurance scheme. And you know that in price discrimination, market A should not see what is happening in market B. Mm-hmm. So if you put all of us into one basket and you say you have developed four different premiums, there's no way you can correct it. Mm-hmm. So these vulnerable people, the informal economy, will have a flat premium. And then they will collect. So when they collect their own premium, they may, according to our calculation, if they are very efficient, we may get about 30, between 30 to 50% of what they need for their health care. Then the National Health Insurance Levy, which comes through the VAT system, will be used to support them. If you are lucky, we can cover all their costs. If not, then government can add a little bit to it.
Okay.
And we are also expecting that they will get a lot of help from the development partners, because these are the vulnerable groups. And already we have some of the development partners who spend a lot of money through the health system. And IRO is working with two of them in the country right now, which is working to even pay the premium of the vulnerable people in the society.
Okay.
So they will get a lot of help. And government may not add a person to it, or if they add, it will be very small. Call it 5 to 10% of what they need.
And what was the third one? Yes.
The third one is what we call the National Mutual Health Insurance Schemes. And we recommended 5 schemes.
Uh-huh.
And the 5 schemes, they will share, in the beginning, we will share the 5 to 8 million people whose premiums could be tracked through the payee system. We will share it equally to the 5 schemes. And we tell them that each person can stay in the scheme from the beginning up to maximum 3 years. After that, you can move to any scheme that you think that can serve you well. And we are setting up a competition for these 5 schemes to work efficiently to make sure that you retain your people, because you get the money almost free of charge through the payee system. They collect it straight away through Senate and it comes to you. And if it is not enough, then it's up to management and their staff, I mean employers and their staff, to sit down and develop through their collective bargaining system how much they can add to it to pay for their health care. Because that is what we were doing in the olden days without health insurance.
How different was that from the first one?
Pardon?
The mutual scheme, how different is that from the first scheme that you talked about?
The difference is that the scheme is owned by the people who are paying, by the employers and their workers. And they have come together to pool their resources together to look after their workers. And the research showed that they will make a lot of surpluses in such a, mind you, these are also the type of operation that they don't fall sick very often because they are taken care of. I mean, they receive salary every month, they eat well, they sleep in good places without mosquitoes and without gastronomic infections and other things. So these days we have hypertension and diabetes, but that can also be managed. You see, so the quality of the population is very high. In health insurance, when we say quality of the population, we mean the number of people who visit hospital in a year, the percentage of people. So if you have 100 people and 10 will visit hospital per year, and then another 100 people, 50 will visit hospital per year. Visit hospital is in better command, that they will fall ill and pass through treatment and get well. That then in health insurance say they have visited hospital.
Okay.
Yes. If 10 will visit, then your quality of operation is very good. And if it come as low as 50% or 60%, then you are in trouble because you have to pay a lot of money.
So what happened? Yes. So with all these three recommendations, then what happened? Which one are we implementing now?
Access 50 put all of us in one social scheme, one huge national social health insurance scheme. But the difference between Access 50 and Act 852 now pertaining was that they said it should be run by the district. So each district had its own scheme, and they call it mutual scheme. And I told them that it's not mutual because it's not owned by the subscribers. It was being operated by government, and government was campaigning. Politicians were campaigning to say that, oh, health insurance is there. Those days, 10 cities, your health care is taken throughout the whole year.
Those days, I mean, what we practiced at the time wasn't health insurance?
It was health insurance. Yes. It was a social health insurance, but they wrongly target as a mutual health insurance, which was not. And two, they could not discriminate in the premium. They developed four premiums. Those days it was 10 cities, 20 cities, 30 cities, and 40 cities. But nobody mentioned the 20 to 40 cities. The only politicians only mentioned 10 cities. So people rushed in, registered, oh, you pay 10 cities the whole year, your health need will be taken care of. Then at the end of the day, we found out that the money they are collecting is not even paying 20-25% of the cost of healthcare of all of us.
Why didn't they implement it as you had prescribed?
It was political because in the beginning, we discussed it extensively. I remember Dr. Nani was the Minister for Health in the beginning when President Kufuor took over. And he asked us to calculate the amount of money we need to run one huge social health insurance scheme. And we came up with almost, in those days, the OECD, it was almost close to 1 trillion.
1 trillion?
Yes.
And
it was around 986 million US dollars, closely to 1 billion.
$1 billion?
Yes, $1 billion.
For a year?
Yes, for a year. And when we showed to him that this is very, very difficult for government to, because at that time, when Kufuor took over, do you know that the whole Ghana GDP was valued at $4 billion?
Yes.
So we told him that this cannot be possible. But the politicians are very optimistic people, so they said that it will be possible.
Yes, but you had recommended three forms.
Yeah.
They said they could go ahead and implement. Then they lumped everything together.
Yeah. And had Access 50. Mm-hmm. And the Access 50 made the National Health Insurance Council, which should be the authority to regulate the health insurance. And then the district were running the health insurance by itself. But unfortunately, each district set up its board. So at that time, we had about 170 districts, and we had 170 boards.
What's wrong with that?
Oh, what board do you pay them? The board, every month they go for a meeting and you pay them. Mm-hmm. Where do you get the money? And you are collecting 10 CDs as premium. So everything fell on government.
So right from day one, we got it wrong.
Yes. you got it wrong. We didn't consider our population, the quality of our population, and the type of schemes that will be suitable to them. And that is why we are in this mess. Then ask 852 worsen the entire situation.
How did it worsen the entire situation?
Because when they were running the district scheme, it made people to write through the scheme. The district made a lot of publicity, and the people write there to register. And they were running the scheme part of the day. So within 3 years, we had over 50% national coverage. Then they made us Act 852 and centralized health insurance like SNIT, that we have National Health Insurance Authority, which is also the implementer of the health insurance scheme. And I said, this is not possible. The health insurance, national
health
insurance.
You said this is not possible to who?
Not to Ghana, because our population will not support it.
But did you tell the, those in authority that this wasn't possible? Who did you speak to?
I spoke to, by that time it was Mensa, who was there.
Sylvester Mensah?
Yeah, Sylvester Mensah.
You spoke with him?
Not speaking, I presented a written proposal. And he looked at it and he said he would study and call me, and he never called me.
During the implementation under the NPP, didn't you guide them through the implementation since you had developed it?
Oh, I did in some few occasions, especially the two boards that were set up. I was invited to go and orientate them to understand health insurance.
Which boards? The district boards?
No, the centralized
board. Yes. And in orientating them, didn't you tell them that this wasn't going to work?
I did.
What was their response?
Oh, people, that's what I'm saying. The politicians are at times very vehemently optimistic. And they think that, they thought that, and I told him that it doesn't work anywhere in the world. I even used the Great Britain example to tell, look at the quality of population in Great Britain. The number of people whose contribution could be tracked through the payee system compared to ours. I gave you the statistics from the beginning. And even that, they have a huge money. They do it through the tax system. Everything that you pay tax, NHIS is on it. So the money is there. But the implementation is so bureaucratic that when you are on operation, you are dying. You can wait for 3 months, and people die just like
so
that.
So right from day one, we got it wrong.
We got it wrong.
By playing politics with
yes.
it. And then when we started, you warned them.
But ironically, when we were designing the health insurance with SNIT, and you know, SNIT board is tripartite, employers, workers, and government. At the tripartite, I was then a board member representing the Ghana Employers Association. So during that discussion, I saw that they were going wrong, so I prepared a paper and made a presentation. That was the time that they got to know that I have knowledge in health insurance. So they said, that, oh, okay, then you lead the team to design. And I told them that you cannot do politics with health insurance. And I gave them the German example. Germany started health insurance in the world by the youths who were there. Mm. Groups came together, put their resources together. So when one of us is ill, then we can look after him or her. So, and it developed so well, nice mutual schemes, but it survived the two world wars. Do you know how the two world wars devastated Germany? But health insurance survived. The reason was that it wasn't political. It was mutually owned by the people.
And in Ghana, what has happened? We've politicized it.
Yes. Everybody knows that it's government who owns health insurance, and government is looking after my health. So I have workers. I'm paying average of about, say, 500 per worker per year. Then government bring it. He said, oh, their Social Security can pay it. So I'm okay. You rest your soul. And then all that you have to do is to those, I think currently it's about 4 cities or 5 cities to get a health insurance card for your worker. And it's finished for the year. The next year, I pay another 5 cedis or maybe 10 cedis, get a card, and you are there.
We'll come back to focus on the health insurance as it is currently, because we've looked at the planning stages, how you wanted it to be, and what we decided that it should be. We'll look at its progress now also. What is wrong with the health insurance after this break? Stay with us. We'll be right back. And this afternoon, we're talking to the one who led the team of experts to design Ghana's National Health Insurance Scheme, Mr. Kwamina Amaosi Andoh. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this break. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues on TV3 with me, Winston Amwen. My guest this afternoon is the one who led the team of experts to develop the National Health Insurance Scheme. This afternoon, we're focusing on the National Health Insurance Scheme. So now we know the processes that we went through in developing it. We're now coming to discuss the state of National Health Insurance Scheme now in our country, Ghana. So Mr. Amaosi Andoh, now what is the state of the National Health Insurance Scheme as we speak?
Currently, it's in a very bad state. Providers, you know, the minimum mm-hmm. provider, those who provide the services yeah. for their subscribers, hospitals, right. Radiography centers, all the other services in medicine, the average number of months we are owing them is about 11 months. Mm-hmm. Yes. And when you, when you reach that, then three things are happening. Hospitals cannot provide the services because they cannot buy the drugs and other material to look after the people. And then the health insurance scheme cannot pay. The subscribers are on them. That you go to hospital, when you go to hospital, the best you can get is the consultancy, which is free. Then they will write the drugs for you or the laboratory for you to go and pass through the system, pay yourself. So you get peeved, and when you come, when you pass through, when your card get finished, get expired, it's not likely that you will renew it. So you see that the registration in Ghana Health Insurance is very high, and yes, retention is very low. So most of the time, new people are registering, and then when they get, they don't get the service, then they refuse to register.
Why are we unable to pay these people?
Because we don't have the money.
Why don't we have the money?
Because the way we have designed it, the money is not there.
Didn't you put in place a mechanism to get us money to pay for these
things? No, I said that the quality of operation we have, mm-hmm. if you design one social health insurance scheme with one low premium, you cannot discriminate with premium because it's the same market. So if you say, the premium is 10 CDs up to 50 CDs, if I can, how do you look at
yes,
my
but I
face
believe that in deciding to go for a one
yes.
scheme,
yes.
at least you were consulted. You said yes. you had advised them.
Yes.
Did you advise on how we were going to generate money
yes.
to run the scheme?
Yes,
what was the advice you gave them?
We are going to generate money in mm-hmm. three ways. Mm-hmm. The tax system that we have there, the NHIS mm-hmm. tax, then the SNET contribution, and then the premium. But the people who are paying the tax, and the people who are paying the screening contribution, I've told you the number in the population. They are less than 2 million.
But lots of people buy, the National Health Insurance Levy. I mean, even if you are an informal person, once you buy stuff, you're giving, VAT percent. Giving VAT. So
yes.
lots of Ghanaians, that's how it's an indirect tax. Lots of people
doesn't go to the NHIS direct.
Where does the money go to?
Government retains the money. And by the time the government pays the money to them, they are rushing. For example, currently we are owing about 10, 11 months. So as soon as government put money into the account, they have to rush to pay the providers. So they don't have the opportunity to manage the money through the financial system to make extra money on top of what is contributed. And then the subscribers themselves are not also paying. And those who are paying for the first registration, the money they are paying is so small compared to the healthcare cost that we are having.
Who is paying small money?
If I go and register mm-hmm. now, you will pay premium. Mm-hmm. And the premium they have prescribed to you, they look at the least vulnerable person who is earning little income, some income, to determine the premium. So if you pay that premium, our calculations say that it cannot even pay 20% of the cost of the health insurance scheme per annum. Mm-hmm. So the difference, the 80%, should come from the NHIS levy and then those SNET contributions. And when you put all of them together, if it comes on time, maybe the maximum you can make will be about 80%. There will be extra 20% to be added by government. And government hasn't got the money. Hmm. So that is the issue.
But yes, but in designing that plan,
yes,
what did you advise be done, for instance, in investing that money, in managing those funds properly to ensure we do not have these problems?
Oh, that one, every well-designed health insurance, including what we did, mm-hmm. has got a very robust financial management department, which the money coming in, there should be an expert there to invest the money. But that is when the money comes. If they don't, give you the money, even if you have the expert sitting there, they cannot manage it.
Experts will do what?
To manage the money into the in the financial market.
How do they manage the money?
Well, they invest it. They invest money mostly through blue chip investment because it's people's healthcare money. So you cannot bet it on very high yielding interest, which has also got a high risk.
Former corporate affairs manager of the National Health Insurance Authority, Ameto Kwame, was all over the place saying that they were investing the money.
Oh, no, that one is it was a political talk. He knew that they were not getting the money.
Hold on. It was you doubted him when he said
that? Yeah. But he himself knew that it wasn't true.
How do you know he knew he wasn't getting the money?
But why is it that they couldn't pay the subscribers? How can you go and invest the money without paying the subscribers, the providers who are providing the service? It is after you have certified the providers, it's the surplus that we invest. So as soon as you are owing your providers 8-10 months, 1 year, then you don't have any money to invest. It's very clean like that.
Why are we unable to retain them? I mean, the members who get onto the scheme.
Because you are unable to satisfy them. You pay premium so that when you go to a hospital, you will be taken care of. But when you go there, even though you have the card, in fact, there some hospitals, they do it so sadly. If you go, the health insurance, card bearing members have their own queue. And those who are paying upfront, the cash and carry, have their own queue. Cash and carry people will go by 12, everybody is gone, and the health insurance card bearers will still be in their queue. The reason is that if they take their money to look after you, it will take 1 year, 10 months for that money to come without interest, and they will be in trouble. So it's not wickedness, but they are trying to manage in such a way that they can get money upfront to run their own businesses.
I mean, just curious, why is government unable to pay these money to, you know, the health insurance authority?
Who this one, I'm not answering this question as a health insurance, but as an economist. I think that government finances at certain stages, especially the last administration, we knew that, I mean, we had a lot of expenditure against our revenue. And therefore, I mean, revenues coming were very hot cake. And the you have to do what we call scale of preference. And if the one who is developing the scale of preference thought that health insurance can wait a little bit, then that is the cause.
Is there any innovative way the National Health Insurance Authority can generate funds, you know, of government or, you know, from the private sector and then invest it to ensure that the National Health Insurance works very well?
Yes, that is the system we have developed. That is the system I described with you. If you allow the highly rich people to run their own scheme, private for commercial, they go to the commercial scheme, then we run one social health insurance scheme for the vulnerable, for the informal economy. We develop the subscriber to collect their own premiums. As I said, they will be able to collect close to about 30-40% of their own money that they need. Then another 40% will come from the levy, NHIS levy, which is coming through the VAT system. So we will have maybe
But that's the one that government doesn't pay. I mean, you just told me that
The government should pay.
Government doesn't pay now.
That is what I'm saying, that it doesn't mean that no government will pay. Now we are making it public, and actually the public know. So the subscriber association we are talking about, they will make sure that government pay.
But talking about having the high class with their own insurance, it's something that happens now, where people who have gone for their own, you know, insurance schemes, they're not relying on the national health insurance.
Yes.
So that in itself takes away that stress. Why is this still not working? I mean, the solution you're proposing now is something that is already in place, isn't it? And yet, it's not working.
No, you see, the 2 million people who can pay additional premium in addition to their health insurance contribution through the SNES system are all going into the same pocket. But when we divide them, they will run a very viable scheme, get a lot of surpluses, and they will plow back. It's a mutual scheme, so it's not a company by profit, company limited by guarantee. So the surplus that they, that's why I'm not using the word profit, surpluses that they make will be plowed back into the health system. they can develop the claim management system for the mutual, for the social health insurance scheme. They can do all sorts of things that will help the social, national social health insurance scheme to run efficiently. So that all those things will not be a cost on the social health insurance scheme.
Mr. Amaosi, yes. Now the point is that currently you go to lots of organizations. They have, yes, their own health insurance system.
Yes.
The employees go to work, they bring it back, the company pays for it.
Yes.
They do not go to work with national health insurance cards.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You have others who have personally, families, deciding that we would want to go for our own health insurance scheme. That is there. You have the vulnerable, pay your, proposal, being those on the national health insurance scheme, mainly. Because many of those who work just pay, but do not actually, you know, use the service.
Every employer is praying for my system to come to being. Because
how do you know that?
Because the amount of, it's cost-benefit analysis. If you take, if they take the, what SNET you are already contributing, the 18.5%, and 12.5% is going to the health insurance, instead of taking care of your worker, it's taking care of everybody in Ghana. The new scheme shows that let it take care of those who are contributing in their own mutual scheme. If they make surplus, we will plow their surplus back into the health system by way of developing the hospitals, developing the radiography centers and all areas, so that health system will be efficient. So it may happen that you are not even contributing anymore. Currently, you are paying 12.5%, which is part of the 18.5% you are contributing, and yet your worker brings you a bill and you pay. So what we are saying is that we want to run an efficient system which will not make you to pay an additional this on your worker, or even if you have to pay, it will be very small. And in fact, my calculation, normally we are very pessimistic. We are very, we try to be not, to be so assuring. Okay, I don't know the word to use, but they can do as much as 90-95%. So the 10% left, if they say that they want to share and still pay upfront through the collective bargaining system, worker and manager or worker and employer agree that, oh, we will add 1% more or 5 more 0.5% and you will share it 0.3 and 0.2, it will be very small, okay? As compared to when I go to your whole clinic now and bring you the bill, you have to pay. Or SNET hospital or any other hospital which are now looking at the private sector. So every employer is praying for it.
Okay, so beyond these, going for the three-tier system which you propose, for instance, in the current state that we have it, what can we do to make sure that it works even as we have it without necessarily having a three form?
If you don't redesign the health insurance and run one huge social health insurance scheme, it will not work. It has never worked in any country. I was part of an ILO team which investigated why health insurance collapsed in Philippines. Within 3 years, they blew $5 billion.
And why did it collapse?
Because it was the same thing, like I had one huge social health insurance scheme, and everybody was paying the lowest premium. That they also did like ours. They did four level premiums, and nobody paid the 2, 3, 4. Everybody paid the least. But well, that's what the politician told them, that oh, now there's a new health insurance system. You go and pay this premium, and the whole year we take good care of you. And everybody, the haves and have nots, they all pay the same.
But the impression is created. The impression is created that there's a loophole within the system. Once we pluck that loophole, we're good to go. Once we ensure that, okay, monies that get to the National Health Insurance Authority, monies that get to, you know, the service providers are checked, that's the end we go.
No, we, our calculation, what you are saying is true. Normally, in health insurance, there's something we call claim management system. That is,
we'll get to the claim management system. Yes. We'll definitely get to the claim management system. We need to go for a short break. When we return after this break, we'll look at the claim management system and how that is going to help improve our health insurance scheme. And then we also look at the famous one-time premium that we've talked about in Ghana over the years. Is it a feasibility? Is it something that is feasible? Can we pay a one-time health insurance in our dear country, Ghana? Stay with us. We'll be right back. We'll be right back. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues on TV3 with me, Winston Amwa, and this afternoon we've been joined by Mr. Kwamina Amaosi, Andoh, who led a team of experts to design the National Health Insurance Scheme as we have it now. So we've been talking about claim management. Yes, Mr. Amaosi, Andoh, I mean, we have been giving the impression if we manage the claims, we're good to go, isn't it? So why are you talking about, you know, going for the original plan when we've all been made to believe that it's a problem of money, and the money is the claim management?
When you say claim management, it's not the money from government, but the providers, providers claiming the services that they have rendered to your subscribers. So you have the health insurance scheme, you have registered subscribers and offloaded to me that I should treat them when they are ill. And then when I finish, I bring you my claim and then you will pay. This health insurance all over the world has got a serious problem with claim management. But luckily for the world, Ignis, an IT company in Utah, in the US, started working on it about 50 years ago. And almost every year, Ignis bring a new system. And now several other companies, QuadraMed and other companies that I cannot mention, all of them here, have developed very efficient system to run claim management system. And basically, claim management system are run by former people with hospital knowledge, nurses, pharmacists, doctors, who also have some financial background, and they are trained on the claim management system to be able to, when the claims are come first, they should be able to see the treatment, whether it follows the treatment protocol agreed, and then whether all the prices quoted are the same. And then they now ask the computer to process and pay.
Do we have that system in Ghana?
We have, but it's not very efficient.
Why isn't it efficient?
That one I can't tell, because you can have the system without having the qualified people to operate it, and vice versa. So why it's not very efficient? Because, you know, last week it came to the papers that one region, I think Ashanti region or so, they have saved 150 million Ghana cedis through the claim management system. And I said, wow, one region. So if it is, you know, Ashanti is the biggest region. So if, I mean, you scale it down to each region does the same, we can easily have 1 billion money saved. So claim management system is part of the game. But if claim management system is not working, you don't get the payment through the government to you early to be able to invest the surpluses so that you can earn extra income into the system. If all these things are not working, it is very difficult. But you can be very efficient in claim management, get government contributions, but it may not suffice.
And
because the premium that the subscribers are paying is so small. Currently, it's less than 20%.
So you're saying that we must increase the premiums that, you know,
no, when we increase the premium, the vulnerable people cannot pay.
So what do?
We have to dichotomize them.
We have to go for the three way approach that you propose.
Yes.
So the new government says it wants to make NHIS work.
Yes.
What should the government do to make it work?
Yes, thank you. The government should let us redesign the NHIS and change the current Act 852. We will make National Health Insurance Authority not to run health insurance. They will only supervise health insurance.
Who should run it?
The health insurance will be run by the social health insurance scheme, will be run by a CEO, and there should be National Social Health Insurance Scheme. As for the private, they are doing the, and we won't go there. Then the mutual schemes will be run by different companies, five different companies with five CEOs. We will advertise and recruit them and let them share the those people who can be tracked through the payee system, and then we will do that with the consent of their employers. So it will be employer-employee government scheme.
Are you not creating another scheme, bureaucracy for the NHIS?
No. That's one. They are directly running their own scheme. NHIS will register the scheme. They will develop the card. they will make sure that they collect the money from government and say, and they pay through the National Social Health Insurance Scheme. They will audit, develop a very efficient audit department to audit the mutual schemes and the social health insurance schemes. They will develop the treatment protocols, and then they will also set up the premium review the premium as and when necessary. So they will be supervisory to make sure that the system works. So the social health insurance scheme has its own CEO who will run. The subscribers will collect the premium as much as they can. We will support them with the national health insurance levy. And then we will open the avenue for development partners to also come in and assist the vulnerable group. As for those who say premiums are paid through the PAYE system, they are okay. Mm. And the calculations say that they will even make surplus to pry into the health system to help build hospitals, especially the machines and equipment that the doctors and the nurses and pharmacists, everybody need to really do good diagnosis are not there. Okay. And this is what we should do.
Is it possible to have a one-time premium?
No, it's not possible.
Why can't we have a one-time
premium? No, the one-time premium, I just don't know where it came from. And you see, when we did O-level economics, mm-hmm. we did demand and supply curves. And they taught a perfect rate supply curve and perfect rate demand curve. They are the extremes which help us to understand the subject. But it's not practicable. The condition that you need to run one-term scheme is not even available in Great Britain, let alone Ghana.
What are the conditions that you need?
I will give you only three of them.
Go ahead.
Okay. You need to have a population which will be able to pay about 15 to 25 years premium on the spot. So currently, if the premium is 50 cedis, 5, 12, 60, so 600 cedis per annum. So you multiply by 15 to 25 years. If people can pay minimum of 15 and maximum of 25 years, you know what? Well, you know the reason? When I get the money now, mm-hmm. I quickly go and invest the money and then use the inflow, the interest that I'm making out of the money to look after you, to pay for the providers to serve my subscribers. And it is not possible. I mean, even 1 year premium, people are not paying, let alone 15 minimum and 25 maximum years. That is one. And the two is that we don't have quality of operation. We have that money to pay. And three, we also have very limited investment receptacles in Ghana. Even that is a very weak if you put it in treasury bill, that's okay. Especially in current situation that we have. But the first one is to be able to pay a big number of years in advance. So when they say one-term premium, it doesn't mean that you pay 10 cedis once and it's okay. No. You will multiply the 10 cedis by 25 years you pay so that we can invest the money and use the inflow in the form of interest to look after you. And it doesn't work that way.
So that whole plan is MSP?
No, when you were studying health insurance, especially those who specialize in actuarial studies, those people who see the health of the annuities, the time series analysis. And you will do a lot of theoretical issues to make you understand the issue properly. And one-time premium is one of them.
So you're giving us two reasons. What's the third one?
I gave you three. I said that the investment receptacle is weak in Ghana, but you will not even get the money to invest. So that one is not even very issue. But the most important issue is the quality of the population. 50% of us are children. They are not contributing anything. So it's very difficult.
What if we choose to increase, for instance, the National Health Insurance Levy? Wouldn't that be enough to support a one-time premium?
If the employers and their workers are prepared, the National Health Insurance Levy, we are talking about the VAT.
The VAT, yes.
Okay, the VAT is also, we are in West Africa and we are trying to harmonize. So I'm not sure whether we'll be able to go beyond 17.5%. I don't know.
But what if as a people, we decide, okay, we want to go beyond this. We want to pay, say, 5% national health insurance levy.
If we do so,
can we achieve a one-time premium?
You see, Winston.
Yes, sir.
The problem is that research has shown that one social health insurance scheme, one of the reasons why it has never worked is that, not that it's only money is not there. You may have money there, but the bureaucracy it creates and the loopholes it creates for stealing and dishonesty and other things make it unworkable.
Okay.
So you may even put in the money, but it's like a basket. It will leak.
Mm. Do you feel sad when you look at the health insurance scheme based on what you proposed?
Yes, I feel very sad because I feel that Ghana has got the people around who knows what to do, who know what to do.
Have you offered to help?
Oh, I've told you that I not just an offer. I presented with my team a paper to the National Health Insurance Scheme.
Would you want to help now?
Yes. If we are given the opportunity, we are prepared to help.
Kwamina Amaosi Andoh, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. We're very grateful. So you heard from Kwamina Amaosi Andoh, who led a team of experts to develop the National Health Insurance Scheme in Ghana. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon on Hot Issues on TV3 with me, Winston Amwa. Make sure you make a date with me on Monday on Sunrise on 3FM 92.7 from 5:55 a.m. to 10 a.m. Have a lovely weekend.